Now to look at power factor correction. Now hopefully by now you've realized there are good reasons to have your power at unity, or try and get your voltage and your current as close to unity as possible, and also removing harmonics. So let's just go into some of the forms of power correction and show you how and where that power factor correction can be implemented, because that does have an effect potentially on the equipment and the wiring in your environment, whether it's in your home or whether it's in a large industry. So if we're looking at power factor correction, you're going to hear the terms called passive power factor correction, active power factor correction, and dynamic power factor correction. Then we've also got harmonic filtering. Now this whole topic of power factor correction is a fine art. There are people who work in electrical engineering who specialize in this, especially for big industry where potentially the costs from your electrical company can penalize you if you're not going to do something about this. So there they will first of all go and evaluate how much it's going to cost and what it's going to take to implement good power factor correction, and then you have to weigh up the kind of penalties you're going to pay from your electrical company, whether it's worth implementing power factor correction. And those, when you implement it, it's a case of understanding what technologies and where you place them. Now, a passive power factor correction, you're just using a static component. So if we've got a case here where I've got an inductive load, so on the circuit, I've got a resistor and an inductor, probably a motor. And this is where most of the power factor correction happens. Big industry is using big induction motors and the like, so that is generally their problem. There isn't as big a focus on capacitive loads. So if we look at this diagram, you would have to understand and go and calculate what power factor correction components you need and their values. And this is going to become very important. I'm going to show you in a demonstration, and we're going to talk about those little gimmicks which they try and sell you to plug into home to correct your power factor and improve your electrical bill. So there you go, and I've done this for the motors on my bench. I'll pop up the calculation now so you can actually see. I'll put a link below to the site. You can go and use this. You need to enter certain parameters, and then it'll pop out a value for, let's say, a capacitor or inductor or what have you that you need, or even resistance to do your power factor correction. Now, as it so happens, for that inductive load, I need about 7.5 microfarad. And that would be passive because it's a single component which isn't going to change and is hopefully going to correct that. But that's obviously for a static load. If this motor varies, let's say this motor is pulling something and that load varies, that will change the dynamics of the power draw and the power phase. And then if you've got a static power factor correction in there, a component which is doing that statically, your power factor will go out. It will certainly help, but things will go out. And that's where we move to active power correction. Active power correction in things like switch power supplies, they will have the relevant components, filtering for harmonics, boost converters to help get the shape of the waveforms corrected so that that power factor correction works and will adjust to the load of the power supply. Now, some of these active solutions can even contain banks of capacitors inside big boxes with big switches on them, which switch on various capacitors depending on the capacitor value to adjust for the varying load. Now, that can cause transients and spikes, so that needs to be taken into account. And also, it's not going to react that quickly. If you've got loads which are changing fairly quickly, you can't have that kind of switching because it is going to create too many transients and spikes on your power line. And that's when you get to dynamic power factor correction. And that's where they're starting to use solid state switching, which can easily switch in the relevant amount of inductance or capacitance to get your voltage and your current in phase, and do that without creating transients and upsetting the power line. Then also, as noted, with that power factor, we're talking about harmonic filtering. In this case, the little example I'm showing relates to, this is a passive solution. It's not going to change. You've got to kind of set it up for a certain amount of harmonics. These are low pass filters. So you get T filters and you get pie-shaped filters, which are formed like this, and they are set to allow lower frequencies through. So let's say you've got 60 hertz, which is your operating mains voltage. You know your harmonics are fundamentals of that and are higher. If you put a low pass filter to, let's say, allow everything below 100 hertz pass, then potentially you're going to start filtering out your second, third, fourth, fifth harmonics. But these aren't dynamic. You do get dynamic filtering, which again will adjust for various frequency requirements and what have you. I say it is a fine art. If we look at the circuit up here where I've got that kind of inductive load, let's say I've gone and put in my 7.5 microfarad capacitor. If I didn't have that capacitor to correct the power factor or to bring my voltage and current back in phase, I would have that reactive power going sent back to my source. So we've got that green line is showing us the real or true power coming in to power our load. Then I've got, let's say, that flux, the magnetic flux from the coils inside the motor collapsing, generating reactive power, and that will be just sent back over that wiring to the source. So if we look over here, at this point in the circuit, your wiring, your fuses, your switch gear, whatever, has to cater for both the real power and reactive power passing that point. So if we have to go and put a clamp meter, and we're going to do this on the bench, and take a measurement there, you're going to see a higher current passing this point because of both of those passing over here. If you go and put in your power factor correction capacitor over here, then what happens? Then if you follow the blue line, our reactive power be stored in the capacitor and then go back to our load. It wouldn't pass this point. So then we'd only be measuring the true or real power coming in. And that's why it's always useful to try and get your power factor correction as close to the load as possible, so that you're minimizing how far your reactive power is traveling across your network. Now it depends. If we have a look at, let's say, this situation over here where I've got more of an industrial setup, I've got the grid coming in. This line represents an entry point or a service point entry into, let's say, a big factory which has got big motors. We've got various loads on their circuit. If they didn't have any power factor correction, we'd have the real power coming off the grid and that reactive power being pushed back out onto the grid, which of course the power company is going to penalize you for. Why? It's going onto their transmission lines through their switch gear. They're going to have greater heat losses and resistance losses across their cabling, and that's why they penalize you for it. Now, towards the end of this video, we're going to come back and discuss why sometimes having reactive power on the grid is actually a good thing because it stabilizes it. But anyway, ultimately, you're going to get penalized, and there's a couple of ways they might implement power factor correction. Ideally, I said it might be best to do it near the load, and if that's the case, we can see the solid red line to the solid capacitor over here near an inductive load, then your reactive power would only be traveling a short way. It'd be staying right near your load. It wouldn't be going across your internal wiring in your factory or industry and through your switch gear. However, sometimes it may be more economical to do all your power factor correction at the service entry point. Where the grid's coming into the factory or industry, you place your power factor correction there. So you still prevent it from going out onto the grid and being penalized, but you have to carry that reactive power across your internal wiring. But then you're handling that all in one place, as opposed to doing power factor correction at each load. And that comes down to economics, the convenience of where you can put the power factor correction, and the experts who design this who know where the best place is to put it. So before we get down to the bench, let's just quickly chat about those devices which some companies are trying to sell, where you just plug in some device into any outlet in your home. I've got a couple of capacitors here which we're going to use in the practical demonstration. Now, for one, as you realize when we go and do this test, and I showed you that calculation, you need to calculate how much capacitance or inductance or the kind of circuit that you need to do power factor correctly. If you're going to plug into your house an incorrect value, it's not necessarily going to correct the problem. In fact, it may cause other issues, and we're going to talk about resonance as well. But even if they do sell you a device which plugs in and corrects your power factor, your power meter, which measures the amount of true power coming into your home, is measuring in watts and kilowatt hours. So it's not taking power factor into account. So you're only paying for the true power coming into your home. And the electrical companies do not charge residences for any power factor issues. Now, there may be many reasons behind that. For one, it just may be too time consuming. And the power factor issues related to residences aren't big, so it's just not worth pursuing down. However, we do send reactive power back out onto the grid. And if you do happen to implement power factor correction in your home and it does correct the power factor, well, then you are doing a good thing because you are not pushing excess reactive power back onto the grid, which they have to deal with in terms of upgrading or catering for that on their transmission lines and what have you. But you're not going to save any money by doing that. So don't be caught out by the snake oil of these companies who are trying to sell you these magical devices you plug into your home and suddenly save you power. What they do, if you go and have a look at their videos on YouTube, they demonstrate exactly this. They demonstrate how without their device plugged in, you've got more current on your line, and they'll have a clamp meter to show that. They plug the device in and then you see the current level drops, and then they say, there you go, you're using less amps. So now you're going to save money. But hopefully you realize that's not the case. Those amps that they're saving you are the reactive. It's the reactive power which you're not being charged for. The other thing as well, I just mentioned resonance. By going to plug in inductors or capacitors into an AC circuit without proper forethought, especially if they're harmonics and you're not taking care of the harmonics, you can get a situation where you get resonance. And resonance can lead to a point where the impedance of a circuit can change radically, and you can have cases where you get overvoltage, and that can then start damaging equipment on that power line. So again, it's a fine art. It's not something you necessarily want to just play around with. But anyway, let's get to the bench and have a look at the practical. Before we get started with the actual demonstration, let me just show you the setup so you can understand what's going on. First off, I've got two capacitors, one rated at 7 microfarad. This one has got multiple wires. You can set up various capacitances. They're all mains rated, so they're high voltage capacitors. This one, which I know Sean gave me when I was in South Africa, is 15 microfarad. And the reason I'm going to demonstrate this is to show you what happens when you plug in a value which is not set correctly. So from those calculations, I think it was about 7.6 microfarad. We're a little bit off with this one, but fairly close. I've got the fan, so my inductive load is plugged in here. I'm taking my measurements at this point over here, and the capacitor is going to be plugged in over here right next to the load. So without the capacitor, I've obviously got my phase shift between my current and my voltage. I'm going to have reactive power being sent back out through the source, which this will see. So I'll have both true power and reactive power coming through. So that additional current will be measured here. And when I plug in the capacitor over here, hopefully it corrects the power factor and prevents most of the reactive power going back out. So that's what we're going to demonstrate. So we've got our oscilloscope and our Fluke 43B. We've got the voltage waveform being displayed. And what we want to have a look at is when we switch things on. I'll switch on that inductive load. This we used to. We've got our current. There are some harmonics, so we've got obviously a bit of wave distortion, and we can see the lagging waveform of the current. Important things to note here is the power factor is sitting right down, the total true power factor is sitting right down at 0.67. So that's fairly low. If we go and have a look, we do have some harmonics, about 21.0% total harmonics. We can see just the little spike over there. So let's see what happens when I plug the capacitor into the system. And what you want to first look at, we'll come back to the figures, is look at the waveforms here and what happens. The waveforms have now pulled together, although you will notice it is a very dirty waveform in comparison to what it was. And we'll talk about that in a minute. But look what's happened to the power factor. We've gone from 0.6 something to almost unity, 0.97. So I'll just pull that capacitor out again, 0.67 to 0.97. If we go and have a look at the, and just to show you, we can see now our real watts are not far off from our VA because we've got less reactive power being pushed back. If we go and have a look at the harmonics, we can see that the total harmonic distortion has increased. So that's why I said this is a fine art. So here, you certainly would need to get this power factor and the harmonics sorted out. You would need filtering of some sort, which I haven't introduced. But it's just to show you how that waveform is now pulled together
so that we're far closer to unity. The next thing I want to show you is the current. Here, and this is the test I was alluding to, that the guys are trying to sell these snake oil devices for your home. They'll show you the current. We're using 458 milliamp AC currently to drive this load. And when I plug it in, look what happens. We get that drop. And that's because that point, remember, we now haven't got that reactive power or current being pushed back along the line. So our current has dropped. So that means for our internal wiring, what have you, our switch gear, fuses, trip switches, and wiring have to carry less current, which is brilliant. But remember, for your home, this means nothing because you're not paying for it. But that's what they're trying to show in those videos, that you're using less current, therefore you're paying less electricity. Don't be fooled by that. The other thing to have a look at is if we have a look at this meter, which gives you an indication of what you'd be paying for. This is a true power. This is how your meter would work. You can see 36.3 watts, which is showing you, if we go back to the true power, that's the true power figure which you're being billed for. I'm going to pull the capacitor out. So now our power factor has gone out, and you can see still 36, still 36, and that's what you're paying for. Before we move on to the next test, what I want to show you is that we are obviously got an inductive load because our power factor isn't quite at unity and it's showing inductive. By putting in that capacitor, we're still sitting with an inductive load. Now I'm going to put in the capacitor, which is sitting at 15 microfarad. Note what happens. We've put in too much capacitance. We've now got a leading current signal to the point where it's actually gone in the opposite direction in terms of our power factor. We've gone to a 0.61 leading power factor now. So that just shows you, just plugging in capacitors willy-nilly is not going to solve your problem. You need to go through the process of understanding what value you need and also catering for the filtering. And in some future demonstration, we'll also have a look at the filtering. Now, there's something else important I want you to have a look at. With these devices, I'm going to plug the other capacitor in just to demonstrate. Now I'm going to turn off the load. And what do you note? We've got current flowing. We've got 314 milliamp AC flowing. So these devices, especially the ones that you plug into your home, even if they're claiming to save power, if they are left on, and this goes the same for industry as well, if you've got your giant megawatt inductive motor that has got a big capacitor bank sitting there, those capacitors are going to draw a fair amount of current themselves when they're not doing corrective work. So if the motor is switched off and those capacitors are left on, you're going to have that draw, which is going to consume power that you're paying for. So the intelligent power factor correction equipment will sense that a load has been switched off and it'll pull itself out of the circuit. So if I go and pull that out of the circuit, then that loss which is being consumed by the power factor correction capacitors is then switched out of the circuit, so you're not paying for that when it's not required. Just a word of warning with these capacitors. I'm doing this and being very careful. I've got capacitors which are rated to cater for the mains voltage that I'm putting them across. These can be very dangerous. If you don't get the voltage correct and you don't know what you're doing, don't play with capacitors across mains. It can be very dangerous. Also, once they're disconnected, they are going to have a very high voltage across these plug points, which I'm using. So this isn't the best way to do it. I'm just doing this as a demonstration. Just be warned, this can be dangerous.
Now we get to another interesting part, which is another rabbit hole for me, because as I was investigating this topic, this issue of grid stability came up, and it was quite fascinating to see what's involved there. Now, grid stability is critical because if you don't control what's going on in the grid in terms of the use of power, how it's generated, regulation of the voltage, and the reactive power on the grid can start collapsing for a number of reasons. And that happened back in, I think it was 2003 in Canada and the States, where a lot of the power, where a lot of the power networks went down. And apparently the main cause of that was that there wasn't enough reactive power on the grid. Now, when I was looking into this, I was trying to understand why, how reactive power plays a part in supporting the voltage level. And eventually I found a document, but it goes through a ream of complex equations to eventually come out and derive and explain how additional reactive power on the grid will increase the voltage, and if you reduce that, it'll decrease the voltage, so that it can be used as a mechanism to regulate the voltage on the grid. And the electric utilities that run or look after the grid and the transmission lines use this for exactly that purpose. Now, one of the ways they do this is for one capacitor bank. So capacitor banks, as I noted, they can absorb reactive power and then put it back out as well. The one thing to note about reactive power, it doesn't travel very far across the grid. There's large losses with it, and there's an issue associated with that. But these capacitor banks can do that. However, they're not very good when the voltage levels start dropping off. Their performance will also drop off, and they won't be able to inject enough reactive power to support that voltage, and eventually things will collapse. And one of the scenarios which can lead to a big issue is that on the grid, if you start getting the voltage starts dropping off, the one thing the electric companies might try and do is boost the current on the grid to try and stabilize things, but more current at the end of the day can lead to a situation where you get overloads and then things start tripping and switching off, and again the grid goes down. So it's quite a balancing act and an art to maintaining the whole grid network so it stays stable. And the one thing that is used in the States in particular are synchronous condensers. Now, synchronous condensers also go by the name of, they are synchronous motors or synchronous capacitors. And a synchronous motor is different from others. Again, something new to me, but they have an excitation field which can control how they work. And that excitation field can set it in a mode where it either operates as a motor or it acts as a generator. And this is a very helpful property. And so what they do with these motors when they're being used as synchronous condensers is the shaft is actually removed. You won't have a shaft poking out to drive something. They're just free running. So they're encapsulated. In fact, sometimes I think they put nitrogen inside to ensure that in terms of the losses inside and heat, it runs better. And with that excitation field where they've got control, they keep it at a balance where it's sitting on the borderline between being a motor and a generator. And it can either generate reactive power or absorb reactive power. And by doing that, either absorbing, if there's too much reactive power on the grid, which means you could lead to a situation where you've got overvoltage, they can absorb it. Or if there's not enough reactive power and the voltage levels are dropping, they can inject reactive power onto the grid to prop up the voltage. And it's far more robust than the capacitors because they're not going to just, their performance doesn't fall off if there's an issue with the voltage like the capacitor banks do. So you'll find that's a technology which is in use. It's used inside industry. If industry are running huge megawatt motors or what have you, they can also use synchronous condensers right next to them to do their power factor correction and to control the reactive power. Now, one of the big challenges with being on a grid, and this is something we're going to talk about now, is the negative effect of PV, of solar power, large solar power generation on the grid. And I certainly didn't understand the issues until I went down one of these rabbit holes. For a grid to generate its power and to supply customers with their power that they require is a challenge. There's going to be various times of the day when there's going to be peak demand, when people are switching on air conditioners or heating, and when the demand drops off. And that can change. And they have to understand that profile, and they will bring in various types of power generation to cater for that. Now, Anya, I've mentioned there's, let's say, coal power stations, nuclear, hydro, gas, turbine generation. There are many more. But to maintain a kind of base level of power, which doesn't have much regulation, is something like nuclear. Nuclear power being pumped onto the grid cannot be changed very quickly. There's a constant load that it can support onto the grid. And if there are any big fluctuations to that, then things like coal may be able to regulate their power. But in particular, things like hydro on a dam, you can open the sluice gates and shut them. And of course, there's a time period to that, but if you need to adjust a lot quicker, then something like gas turbines can be used. Those can be fired up relatively quickly to cater for a sudden increase in demand. And so they're obviously carefully monitoring the grid to see what power they need at what time. Now we have large PV or solar installations, megawatt installations providing power on the grid. And here comes a challenge. So let's say during the day the sun is shining and we've got some really good power being placed onto the grid, megawatts, hundreds of megawatts. And so the power grid, the management or the supply, the rest of the supply on the grid is being run around that. They can obviously tap off and reduce what they're pumping in because they're getting the supply from the PV. Now all of a sudden, you've got a cloud coming overhead. And what happens? You can suddenly lose megawatts of power from the grid. It just disappears, just like that. And that's the problem. That's where PV suddenly creates this instability of the grid, because suddenly power can be there and it's not. So let's just mention the other sources, things like wind, or you get your solar reflected where you're heating a heat source and turning turbines. They also suffer from whether the wind's going to be there or the sun's going to go from those reflective mirrors where it's heating something. But there's a bit more hysteresis there. Those heating, where you're either heating salt or what have you, even if the sun suddenly disappears, you're going to have perhaps tens of minutes while that power is slowly dissipating. And the grid, they can change their profile of where they're generating their power to cater for that loss. Likewise with wind, if the wind suddenly stops, the wind turbines just suddenly stop producing power. They're going to start winding down. And again, that kind of thing can be catered for. However, PV is a problem. So that's why PV is, in some instances, earning a bad name in terms of being a generation source being plugged into the grid. However, there's a new bit of chit-chat about that. Someone has said that the inverters which are being used for power generation, so you generating your power in DC, it has to go into an inverter to get it into AC to paste it onto the grid. Those inverters, the more intelligent inverters, which can also be controlled remotely, have the capability of changing their power factor. There may be instances where PV production drops off because a cloud comes over, but what the grid could do, if they could remotely control those installations on the grid, is change them so that they play a part, just like the synchronous condensers or the capacitors. They can either absorb or inject reactive power onto the grid. So even if they're losing power onto the grid, they can support it by controlling reactive power, and in that way support the voltage levels so that they have a positive input to the grid in those situations. And that's a new topic which is being brought up. I don't know whether it's been successfully tested, but there are quite a few papers now which are talking about that. But it's certainly an interesting topic to be aware of going into the future. So that's the end of the theory side of this topic. Just before we end off, we're going to go back to the bench. I'm going to go through the few instruments I've got there that can do power quality measurements, just to show what they can do for you in terms of how the measurements are presented. So we're going to have a look at the Fluke 345. We're going to look at the HT instruments and my Fluke 43B. Now, as noted, this is just a brief look at some of the tool sets that I have in my hands, just to have a look at power quality. We're going to have a quick look at the 43B. I've already done a fairly extensive review on the Fluke 345, but we'll just have a look at its power quality measurements and then the HT instruments. Now, the HT instruments, I am going to do a full review. So there's certainly a lot of functionality and features which will come out in that, which I'm not going to be showing here. In terms of availability and pricing, the Fluke 43B is now discontinued. I bought this some years ago. You can still get these, but you're going to pay anywhere from, let's say, if one is in bad condition, I suppose $1,500, but all the way up to $3,000, depending on the current clamps that come with it. The meter that supersedes that is the Fluke 345. It's taken over from this, but this will cost you about $2,700. The HT Instruments HT9022 has a lot of the functionality of the Fluke. It doesn't have the big colored, nice color display on it, but it can do remote data logging and viewing via Bluetooth, and that is something we'll look at in the review. And this costs under $1,000. My Fluke 43B I still really enjoy, because even though it's got a kind of older monochrome display, it's nice and big, the buttons are nice and easy to use, and the navigation makes sense as well. If we go here, as you'll have seen, it's very straightforward looking at the screens. If we're looking in particular at power quality, we can see the waveforms.
We can go and see the power factor. Remember, this is total or true power factor. We can see the displacement power factor. We can go and see our real, apparent, and reactive power. And then it's got a nice display with the harmonics. The keys are very easy to navigate through the actual harmonics and to see what you want to see, as well as nice big clear digits displaying what's going on. So I must say, I really still like this form factor, nice and easy to use. The Fluke 345 really has a nice display. It's obviously smaller than the 43B, but nice color, nice and clear, nice and sharp. I like the waveforms that you're able to view. If we flick through and you get a view of the waveforms, the current, the voltage, and the fact that you can view them together. You can then go and view all your parameters again, which relate to power quality. The one thing I will note though, that's why I mentioned the keys on the 43B. Sometimes with the keys laid out in a pattern like this, it wasn't the most logical or intuitive to use, purely my opinion. I prefer the 43B in that regard, but nonetheless, it allows you to navigate through the various screens to see what the measurements are. You can see, obviously, your voltage AC, your percentage total harmonic distortion. You then get a display with your harmonics on there, and you're able to again go and cursor through and have a look at those harmonics and note the measurements which are related to those harmonics. It also obviously does power and energy measurements, but in this case, we're just looking at the power quality measurements. The HT Instruments HT9022 has a relatively small display in comparison to the others, but nonetheless, it provides all the information that you need. On this is the power quality screen. It's got the real power, it's got the reactive power, and it's got the apparent power. We can see there it says KVARC, so that's capacitive. I've got a CFL light plugged in at the moment. If I go and switch on an inductive load, you can see that change to an I to show you that it is inductive. You can go into the menu system and look at power factor. See here again, if I'm going to switch on that load, you'll see it goes and says inductive. It gives me the power factor. You can see it also gives you distortion power factor. You can go and display your voltage and your current. And then you can do the same for both your current and your voltage. You've got separate screens to go and view your harmonics. So over here you can see right down to, I think, the 25th harmonic, and then it goes back to the first. So you can line up the cursor on each of those, and at that point you can go and read off the measurements for that reading. They've got a harmonic screen for current as well, where you can go and read off the harmonics for your current. Now this, as I noted, obviously this display kind of doesn't kind of match up to what the others can do, but this does have a trick up its sleeve, and that it does have Bluetooth. So you can wirelessly connect either to a PC application or I think a Windows mobile application and have the various displays and logging on that device. This does also do internal logging, so it can be left in place to do logging. But when we get to the full review, I'll go over those features.
So right, that's the end of that tutorial. Thanks very much for watching. I just want to point out that I've done a fair bit of investigation on this, and I'm sure I've made some mistakes along the way. So do keep an eye out below to see if I have made any critical mistakes. Hopefully what I've done is given a fairly broad range and understanding of power quality and the issues around the grid and power factor and what have you. If I've made any big critical mistakes, I'll follow up with another video, but if they're small, I'll either annotate or say, keep an eye on what people are saying below. I certainly do owe a big thanks to Barry of tester.co.uk. Without his support, I wouldn't be able to do these videos. So for one, even just providing something like the Siglent oscilloscope, which has got isolation so I can safely do a demonstration like this, is a big help. If you're based in the UK, do go over to tester.co.uk, because as I say, by supporting Barry, it helps me continue doing what I'm doing. Thanks very much for watching. If you've gained any value, please give us a thumbs up, and I'll catch you soon for the next video. Cheers.